Welcome this afternoon, especially to the family of Alan Myners. William Allen, known as Alan, there's a story there. But welcome to this celebration with thanksgiving of the life of Alan. A life, I believe, marked out by the hallmarks of a Christian person. And becoming especially the family with a deep sense of sadness, but coupled with a tinge of joy as a father, a granddad, a great-granddad, a friend who has claimed his reward of being promoted to glory. A man who lived by the principles of Jesus and his Christian faith. So we're going to commence the service with a song with that amazing third verse. His love has no limits, his grace has no measure. His power no boundary known unto men, for out of his infinite riches in Jesus he giveth and giveth and giveth again. Let's stand and sing these verses together. Thank you.
Thank you.
take your seats. Let's share a prayer together. Father God, we thank you for this day which is tinged with sadness, but a sense of joy in a life that is lived well. I just pray, Father, for the family who sit before us and those who are in the hall, those who are linked in through the live stream, that a real sense of blessing will be theirs, of comfort. The God who comforts, the God who cares, the God who loves, the God who Alan served and enjoyed relationship with all his life. May that same God be the support to each one of us today as we pilot ourselves through this service. And we do indeed thank you for the life of Alan. We thank you for not just here, but down in the South when he was a member of the Corps. We thank you for everything that he did there and then became very much involved here. And we thank you for that, Lord, for his skill with music, his gift of music, his gift of sharing that part of you through music. And we thank you for that. So bless us as we hear words, as we sing, as we share scripture. May you just touch our hearts today and comfort those who are grieving. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. So before Reverend Chris, cousin, who's going to come and bring scripture, and Neil brings a family tribute, we're going to sing another hymn together, another song together, the great song to the tune of Fuster, Colonel Fuster, who was a great army composer, wrote this lovely tune, When Jesus Looked All Galilee So Blue and Calm and Fair. Upon her bosom could he see a cross reflected there. Great words, great music. We'll stay, remain seated and we'll sing these words together. Said in a conversation recently that Alan was great on the piano, beyond all measure, and when an officer, a strange old character, would start a song in his strange key, which the band couldn't have picked up, Alan would be there. Well, I wish he was here and just brought that down a bit, because that was a bit high. You know, we could have done with him just bringing it down a bit. So such was the man. But here's his cousin Chris, Reverend Chris, who's going to read scripture, and then Neil is going to bring a tribute.
just like to thank Ian and the family for inviting me to read scripture. Ian mentioned the word hallmark, and I was thinking myself the same word. I thought, what were the hallmarks of Uncle Alan? And I thought, loving kindness. He was marked by Jesus. And very special to me as an uncle. I'm going to read from Isaiah chapter 35, the whole chapter. The wilderness and the dry land shall be glad. The desert shall rejoice and blossom. Like the crocus, it shall blossom abundantly and rejoice with joy and singing. The glory of Lebanon shall be given to it, the majesty of Carmel and Sharon. They shall see the glory of the Lord, the majesty of our God. Strengthen the weak hands. Make firm the feeble knees. Say to those who are of a fearful heart, be strong, fear not. Behold, your God will come and save you. Then the eyes of the blind shall be opened, and the ears of the deaf unstopped. Then shall the lame man leap like a hart, and the tongue of the dumb sing for joy. For waters shall break forth in the wilderness and streams in the desert. The burning sand shall become a pool, and the thirsty ground springs of water. The haunt of jackals shall become a swamp. The grass shall become reeds and rushes. And a highway shall be there, and it shall be called the Holy Way. The unclean shall not pass over it, and fools shall not err therein. No lion shall be there, nor any ravenous beast come upon it. They shall not be found there, but the redeemed shall walk there. And the ransomed of the Lord shall return and come to Zion with singing. Everlasting joy shall be upon their heads. They shall obtain joy and gladness, and sorrow and sighing shall flee away. Amen.
Dad was a gentleman in the true sense of the word. He was kind, courteous, and honourable. He was such a polite man as well, right up to his final days when even the injections for his pain would receive a thank you. As we were told from a very young age, manners cost nothing. You couldn't call him a disciplinarian, but we learnt by example. More often than not, just a little look, a quiet word, or even silence was all it took for us to realise our halos had slipped. Although breaking a bed in half due to free-fall parachute jumps from a cupboard, bouncing power balls as hard as we could try to try and dent the ceiling tile kitchen ceiling tiles, and washing one of the outside walls with water that unknowingly contained some bleach, were all met with a sterner look than normal. In these past couple of weeks, all those memories have come flooding back. Trips onto Dartmoor, after playing football for a while, Dad would have to sit down saying, I've got a bone in my leg, rubbing it with a wince on his face. Or we'd give three rings to home for our personal taxi to pick us up from youth club or similar. And a tradition that Dad inherited when his own mum died, and all the generations of the family know, whenever clearing the table from any meal that might involve clotted cream, Great William Allen gets to lick the cream spoon. That's an important role which now passes to the eldest of the next generation. So Carol, that's your job now. Also, back in those early years, the family would go on one of our follow our noses days out. We'd get in the car, Mum might have some pasties to take with us, they'd be wrapped in towels and put in the boot to keep warm, off we'd go. But if we were heading somewhere unfamiliar, and this being pre-sat-nav days and West Country road signs, Dad would often need to stop, wind down the window, and ask for directions. Once given, Dad would always acknowledge with the same two words, much obliged. He was never one for material possessions. He'd be quite happy if his only Christmas present was a box of chocolate Brazil nuts. And our family car didn't need to be a Rolls Royce. It was a bright yellow Ford Popular. It just got us from A to B. If it stalled or backfired, he said he'd put kangaroo petrol in the tank. If we were going up a steep hill, he'd get us to push the back of the driver's seat to help. Going over bumps in the road were tummy ticklers, and both Carol and Russ used to get really scared if the petrol gauge was low, and Dad would utter the fateful words, "We're running on the smell." So many happy early memories of Dad, but his own roots are interesting. In 1922, his parents, William Harold and Florence Irene, were married in Yonkers, New York, where William was working. The wedding received a two-column write-up in the newspaper, though it was interrupted halfway through by a small ad for a gas water heater. It said there was standing room only at the ceremony, and the bride-to-be had purchased a one-way-only ticket across the Atlantic. In 1925, the couple had a daughter, Joyce, who sadly died not long after birth. She was buried in New York, and whether it was because of this loss, they moved back to Britain, where they had their only other child, Dad, in 1929. He was born William Allen, William being passed down through the eldest son of each generation, but Dad didn't like it. We're not sure when he switched, but he'd always been known to us as Allen. He went to Sutton High School, where Russ went decades later. Following this, Dad did his national service in the RAF, based in Changi in Singapore, chiefly as a teleprinter operator. He was discharged in August 1949 with the comment that he was very satisfactory at all times. Not being a particularly well-off family and needing to pay his way, after leaving the RAF, Dad became a telegraph boy and spent his working life in the post office, retiring as a branch manager in 1989. He married Mum in 1950 and was devoted to her until she passed away in 2020, just a few months short of their 70th anniversary. For many years, he was Mum's carer, which wasn't always that easy, but he never complained and he did his best to look after her until his own health declined in his late 80s. Dad loved music, and I've wondered from time to time what would have happened if he'd been given the opportunity to study it, but the circumstances wouldn't have allowed, and anyway, it might have hampered his natural talent because Dad was a brilliant musician, not only as a brass player and bandmaster for several years, but as a pianist, organist, and accompanist. And to adapt a phrase from his favorite comedy sketch ever, he played all the right notes in all the right order. He could turn his hand to anything, from a bride's wish to enter to see the conquering hero come, to accompanying Adrian on a sprint-paced performance of Mozart's Horn Concerto. He was also a published arranger of piano duets, which he used to play with Mum. As well as Sunday services, Dad played organs for countless weddings and funerals, but he also lent his talents to others. He would accompany local music events where his skills came into good use. He could play by ear, just hear a tune, and he'd play it complete with harmonies. He was an excellent sight reader, put the music in front of him, and he'd play it. But more than that, he could transpose at sight. We have a newspaper cutting from the late 60s, early 70s, where he accompanied children who'd entered the Plymouth Silver Band's solo and quartet championships. At events like this, a kid playing a B-flat trumpet or an E-flat horn would turn up having learnt the melody from vocal sheet music, which they'd then give to Dad. So he'd have to sight read the accompaniment and transpose it down a tone or up a minor third at the same time, while the kid happily parked away on "Raindrops Keep Falling on My Head" or "Trumpet Voluntary." In complete contrast, once a month he would drive out to Dartmoor Prison to play for a service for the prisoners, usually very well attended because it meant time out of the cells. He did this well into his 70s, and Mum would have kittens, particularly in the winter months, waiting for him to come home. Dad has been a Salvationist all his life and has shared his faith quietly through his music. Over the decades, his playing of the organ at Plymouth Congress Hall every Sunday brought comfort to so many people, as we've read in the number of lovely tributes and messages we've received. Dad wasn't one for the limelight. He just got on and did things, not necessarily offering his services, but he wouldn't say no if someone asked him to help out or do something. He didn't do anything for personal thanks or praise, and he certainly wasn't someone who exuded pride in himself although through the years he certainly had proud moments. In 1977, he attended a wedding that he didn't play for, although he did play a central role. He was there to give away his eldest child and only daughter in her marriage to Adrian. Photos from the rehearsal that the night before, when a large brown and fawn check blanket acted as Carol's train, to her arrival with Dad at Congress Hall on the day, to being one of the crowd looking at the heavily decorated Toyota Corolla as they left for their honeymoon, Dad's face in all these pictures is one of a proud and happy father. And just a few short years later, he became a proud and happy grandfather, first to Rachel and then to Lisa. And something remarkable happened. His real Christian name was no longer a dirty word. Well, not used by his granddaughters anyway. Phone calls from one to the other would be, "Is that William Allen?" And from the other end, "Is that Rachel Louise?" Or, "Is that Lisa Clare?" Only they could get away with it. Or that's how it used to be, because now there's another generation. And to Mia, Max and Isla, great-grandchildren who Dad adored, he happily became great William Allen. He was equally proud of his grandsons. Russ and Sue married in the early 90s, and by the end of the decade, Jonathan and Sean had arrived and will carry the Myners' name and surname into the future. They'll also take a particular classic comedy with them because a shared love of Dad's Army has gone from grandfather to father to grandsons. Technology has also meant that distance has not stopped them seeing each other. And while it was sometimes tricky to get Dad to hold the phone or iPad so the camera could pick him up and not just the top of his head, he was always pleased to see Russ, Sue, Jonathan and Sean, even if it was just to utter the perennial question, "What's your weather like?" "Well, Dad, we hope it's sunny where you and Mum are right now." Dad was the last of his generation in our family. Dad was the last of his generation in our family, but its future is safe. Through Rachel and Mark and Lisa and Glenn, the next generation is already with us. The great-grandchildren, Mia, Max and Isla, whose artwork covered great William Allen's room at Pembroke House, and he loved their visits. There was always a sparkle in his eye when he talked about them. He spent his last 18 months in the care home, and despite the decline in his health, he didn't lose his sense of humour. There was one occasion during his end-of-life care when he needed to have his medication. Lisa, who was the carer on meds duty that day, came into the room. Dad was dozing on and off, and she asked him if he wanted his medicine. He didn't answer, so she said, "Alan, are you with us? Alan, are you with us?" And the sleepy voice replied, "No, I'm with the Woolwich." In a way, that summed Dad up, even in the pain of his final months and on occasions when we thought we were losing him, he'd do something like that. A little word or gesture, and you knew that he was still with us. It goes without saying we love the bones of him, but over the past couple of weeks, we've realised that as a musician, Christian and gentleman, he's touched the lives of so many others as well. And I'd just like to share a few of these because it's been comforting to know that others felt about Dad the way we have all our lives. Mum and Dad's good friends, Ray and Viner, both passed away in recent years. And their daughter, Jane, said, "He was a true friend to my parents, and I'm sure your mum and dad will be having a big chat and catch up with mine. Your dad was a true, gentle and kind man." Elaine, the daughter of Ken Hooper, who was Dad's best man and vice versa. "I always remember his sympathetic accompaniment whenever I sang. He always added something very special without drawing any attention to himself." And just a couple more. "Your dad was an absolute legend, gracious, kind, and incredibly humble regarding his fabulous musical talent." And finally, "I remember your dad as a truly gentle and kind man and a quiet encourager to so many of us." Dad was in end-of-life care for nearly 4 months, and during that time we had a number of comforting emails from our cousins Chris and Sylvia. But there is a line in the one they sent after being told he passed away that I want to mention. For us, Dad was a special uncle, easy to love because of all he gave out. And yes, he was so easy to love, and he passed away knowing how much the three generations he left behind loved him. But Dad, Granddad, Uncle Alan, William Alan, Great William Alan, you can't begin to understand just how much every single one of us will miss you.
Thank you, Neil. Thank you, Chris. Great piece of music. In Isaiah 35, I just caught that phrase, only the redeemed will walk there. Only the redeemed. And we've witnessed a redeemed person. They don't come our way that often. But we have witnessed a redeemed person. My thoughts kept coming back to what I was going to say today, and I've always got a lot to say, as you know, but on these occasions, you want it to be the right thing to say. And I kept thinking of the word hallmark. The hallmark. The hallmark, it has been a mark on a piece of jewellery since the 13th century. And it's made up of several elements, including a mark denoting the type of metal and purity, the maker's mark, the year of marking, and by looking at the marks, you know that the article is genuine. So if you could get your wedding ring off, or piece of jewellery, if it's got that mark on it, you know it's genuine. There was a reality TV show, I don't know if it's still going, it was called All That Glitters. And it was about budding jewellers who created masterpieces and who would have judges, and they would advise them how they could improve on what they'd done with that piece of gold or that platinum or that diamond or whatever. And on the odd occasion, the judges would be speechless, absolutely speechless at this bespoke piece of jewellery, by the beauty and craftsmanship of that piece. Well, I think we're a bit speechless today at the hallmark of Alan, that Christian man, that beauty, that bespoke person, in so many ways, in so many ways. And I know without a doubt he has been received into heaven by his maker. And we haven't had to check his mark, his hallmark, not a chance. Might have to check mine, but we certainly won't need to check Alan's, that mark of holiness, because he bore the hallmarks of a Christian. What is a hallmark of a Christian today, you may say, and for those here and those online? Well, in Paul's letter to the church of Galatia in 5:22, he says, "The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things there is no law." Or as the Message translates it in the modern tongue, what happens when we live God's way? He brings gifts into our lives, much the same way that fruit appears on an orchard. Things that are like affection for others, endurance about life, serenity. We develop willingness to stick with things, a sense of compassion in the heart, and a conviction that a basic holiness permeates things and people. We find ourselves involved in loyal communities, not needing to force our way in life, able to marshal and direct our energies wisely. A conviction that basic holiness permeates things and people. I think that speaks of Alan, doesn't it? That holiness, that oneness. And being a Salvationist all his life, he would have sat through a lot of holiness meetings. We won't go down that line at the moment, but he would have sat through a lot and understood it and took that on took on that mantle of holiness. So those words describe a man who embodied the life of Jesus. As John Larson, the late general, wrote, and I've quoted this many times, "To be like Jesus, this hope possesses me in every thought and deed. This is my aim, my creed. To be like Jesus, this hope possesses me. His Spirit helping me, like him I'll be." Maybe I read it because I want to be like Jesus. Maybe I like it because that's my hope. But it was certainly what Alan lived with, and it was true of Alan. He expressed this in his music, as we've heard, as Neil said, a gift he used for God. But you didn't need to be in Alan's company for too long when you would discover something quite special, that Christian hallmark in the conversation. I like that. "Don't tell him your name, Pike." I can see him smiling and chuckling. We all do, don't we? That Christian hallmark, that honesty, that integrity, that transparency, that kindness, that selflessness. What great qualities. During COVID, I did a lot of cooking, and I used to take Alan a meal over, I can't remember, once a week. And he always said it was lovely. I'm sure it wasn't on some weeks. I'm sure it was absolutely disgusting because I did it in a hurry. But every week there was a kind... And I'd come away and I said to Judith, "Do you know, I'm sure last week's wasn't up to scratch, but Alan said he loved it." Such was the quality of the man. Everything, nothing was too much trouble. I remember when we tried to, well, there were a few things. We tried to get him so we could get online. Do you remember that? Changing the tally and which button to push. And yeah, that wasn't the easiest of things. But he was determined to do that because he loved his music and he wanted to have that feeding of God's word. There's times in an officer's ministry when God is present and you feel it. And it was this case a few months ago when I was with Alan in Pembroke with his children, and I shared a piece of music, and because we carry it in our pockets now, it's easy to produce music. Read some words from the songbook and prayed. And you know, there was a real presence of God in the room at that moment. And I firmly believe that presence was because Alan was in the room. And we were dealing with something very special. And for me, those moments are very rare, to come and feel the presence of the angels of God coming in and blessing, and just knowing that, yeah, it's okay. But such was his love for his family, he wanted to hang on, didn't he? He just loved his family, and he wanted to be where you are, because he loved you. There are sacred moments, a moment when God speaks to us all. And that is why, with certainty and confidence, I can say today that Alan has received his reward. That is for all those who bear the Christian hallmark. As our 10th doctrine says, we believe it is the privilege of all believers to be wholly sanctified, and that this whole spirit and soul and body may be preserved blameless until the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Wholly sanctified, set apart, was Alan for the service of God, and no one can doubt that. Neither can I, as I happily say, he is in heaven. And I can't always say that at a funeral, and that's not my decision to make anyway, that's God's. But we know with assurance, for Alan, he is in heaven. I could have spoke from John 14 about Jesus preparing a place for us in heaven, or Psalm 91 about the protection and strength and comfort of God for it all. But for me, it was to celebrate a man marked out and used by God in many ways, and an example to us all this afternoon, a standard, a Christian standard that I would like to think that I myself would try and meet. Thank you, Alan. There's no better word for today than for us all to say yes. Thank you, Lord. Let that be my guide through life. Let that be my benchmark. But I say thank you, Lord, for letting this man cross my path, for I am the richer for it. And please help me to live a life hallmarked by God in every way. God bless each and every one of you. And I salute a soldier gone home for the final time to be with his Maker. Let's sing that great song that's become a great anthem of the church. In Christ alone, says the first line, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength and song. Let's stand together and sing these verses. Thank you, Charlie. I'm going to share a benediction with you. Then the band will play St. Teresa the benediction. And then we will hear The Last Spring by Grieg. But I'm going to use the words from Timothy. And yeah, this is Alan's benediction to us. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Now there is in store for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, has awarded to me on this day. And not only to me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing. And we say, thank you, Lord. Amen. Please sit down.